Good morning, everybody. Why don't you guys stand with us as we open up this morning?
Stone Tower, I am shelter, my shield. You are the home I could never deserve. Here I will serve, ever under your gaze. Here I will serve, ever singing your praise. Tall tower, I am glorious. Tall tower, mighty in power. Our refuge, our defender. Tall tower.
Straight. You are Yeah.
Amen.
You guys can be seated. Today, man, we're so glad that you guys are all here with us this morning. Today, we celebrate 131 years of ministry in the Lakeland community. And it's our Founders Day, and we're so glad that you're here to celebrate what God has done with us. And, you know, we're at this point in our ministry where we're looking forward. What's the next step? And we want to let you know a little bit about what's happening in the life of FPC and what the next step is going to be. And so right now we've got a video to kind of get you ready for that. So take a look at the screens. You know, in Ecclesiastes, we read, there is a time for every season and every purpose under heaven, a time to plant and a time to reap what's planted. At FPC, we're blessed to be surrounded by beautiful trees, which remind us of this principle all the time. God has grown these majestic trees, and they provide beauty and shade and protection.
God's done something very similar with our church. God planted this church, and over these years, this church has grown and matured and sought to accomplish its mission in the Lakeland community to make and mature disciples of Christ. And we've seen quite a bit of harvest as people have invested their time and their energy into the mission. We've seen people come to Christ. We've seen families grown and matured. And now this church is at a place of real stability and strength.
Those who have gone before us have done very well. People have come to know Christ. People have grown in their faith. People have used these facilities over and over again. But it's a time to plant. And that's the name of our new campaign for improvements to the facilities.
Improvements that will help us communicate the gospel in a better way. Improvements that will help us be more warm and welcoming for people to come to know Jesus Christ.
And in the weeks to come, we'll be telling you more about the improvements that will be taking place.
So our hope is that you will join us in this exciting endeavor as God positions us to be a blessing to the people here in our community and to pursue our mission.
In your worship guide today, you can see just a brief history of where we've been as a congregation. But we are moving forward, and we're starting a capital improvements campaign today just to update some of the areas in our church and our church facilities. We use this facilities heavily, and over the last 38 years since we've been in this location, we've really used them pretty significantly to reach people for Jesus Christ. And we invite you over the next couple weeks to just figure out and pray through how you'd like to help make that possible. We're so glad that you're here. We welcome you and ask that everyone would take a moment and fill out the little communication slip that was in your worship guide when you came in, and when the offering baskets come around in just a few moments, that'll just give us a record of your attendance. You can also let us know if you'd like prayer requests or if you have answers to prayer, if you'd like to be on the prayer list, or you would just like the pastors to be in prayer for you, because we do publish this little prayer list that we have every single week so that you can be praying for folks here at FPC. It's an exciting time to be in our church, and we do welcome everyone who's joining us online via the live stream. We live stream this service every single week for folks that are at home who can't make it here because of illness or they're traveling, where they're on vacation. They can still stay connected, and we've had a lot of folks that have been using that, so we welcome you if you're joining us online. A lot of announcements to make mention of. I'm not going to go through all of them. You can all read. We assume most of you can read anyway. Read your bulletins, read your announcements. We do want to let you know that there's a community health fair this Friday, and it's a free health fair. It's a part of our older adult ministry. And also, for the older and younger men in the room, our old men versus youth football game is next Sunday. I had one kid that just got up and said he's ready to go at 1:30 at Bonnie Park. Normally, this is Super Bowl Sunday that we do this. But because we had so many other things going on, we couldn't do it, so we had to push it off. So it's next Sunday at 1:30. Also, you'll be changing your clock backs next week for that. You know, today is an exciting time. We've got the baptismal font out. We're going to be celebrating the sacrament of baptism. Before we do that, let's stand up and let's greet one another and let people know that they're glad that you're glad that they're here.
All right, Nick, you can come down here. What's next?
All right, if everybody could find their seat. Well, as you can see, today is an exciting day, a neat privilege to Quinn's baptism this morning. Obviously, most of you would recognize this family. HL and Nikki and Quinn have been part of this church for several years. In fact, when our family came back to FPC and made our way back into the family of this church 8 years ago, they were here, and they were one of the first families that we met. And my son, Cooper, and Quinn became instant buddies and have been best friends ever since then. So there's been constant sleepovers and carpooling to school and so forth, and it's been just a lot of fun to get to know the family, but also get to know Quinn and to watch him. HL sent me a picture the other day. I think it was hashtag time hop or something, but it was, I'm not technical enough to know what that means, but the picture itself was a picture of Cooper and Quinn, like, from 7 years ago, and it was just crazy. They were both, like, well, Quinn was still a little taller than him, but they were both tiny. But our family has had the privilege of watching Quinn not only grow up and become almost taller than me, but to watch him grow spiritually and to watch as God has grown him and matured him and as Quinn's kind of come to embrace his own faith, it's been a neat privilege. And I know many of you have had that same privilege of watching that happen. So Quinn just went through the confirmation class at our church, and part of the confirmation class for eighth graders is an opportunity for them to say, listen, I know this is what my parents have taught me and what I'm supposed to believe, but is this what I believe? And so they're taught truths about the gospel and about God's grace and about the Bible and about faith. And then for those who have not been baptized previously, they're given the chance to say, I want to be baptized. And so Quinn made that decision Just a little background about baptism real quickly. After Jesus' resurrection, we know that he meets with his disciples. And in Matthew 28, he gives the Great Commission where he says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." So that's our mission. Our mission is to make disciples who make disciples who make disciples, and on and on. And once somebody experiences that grace of God by trusting in Christ, then they're called to be baptized publicly, acknowledging God's work in their heart and life. And so today we have the privilege of witnessing Quinn's baptism. And the meaning and the significance really can't be overstated. Just listen to Paul's words in Romans chapter 6 as he tries to capture the significance and meaning of baptism. When he says, "What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace might increase? By no means." He said, "We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." And so you can hear, as Paul's trying to describe the significance of baptism, there's really at least three things that baptism signifies. One, a death to an ungodly way of life. Paul gives this imagery of kind of going down into a watery grave, that in the same way that Jesus died, that we're invited by faith to die with him to an old way of life. And so this is no small thing, Quinn, that you are publicly saying today that you're trusting in Christ not only for forgiveness, but for the grace to walk a different way of life. And in your generation, that's going to be tough. In our culture and day, it's going to be very tough to follow Christ. But you're making a public statement to say that with his help today, that's what you want to do, that you're saying goodbye to an old way of life. Secondly, it's a new way of life that's freed up to live the way that God intended. And so he's saying that just in the same sense that Jesus was buried in death, but then he was resurrected to new life, when we trust in Christ and die to an old way of life, he gives us the gift of new life, the power to live differently. So you'll have his grace to walk with you along the way. And the last thing it signifies is a radical cleansing. The use of water, we all associate with washing our hands or showers or bathing or any of that kind of stuff, and that was very purposeful. That when Jesus instituted baptism, he would use something that would signify that there's been a radical cleansing of Quinn's heart and life. And that's something we all, if by faith, can remember when we came to Christ, how awesome that was to realize that our guilt has been wiped away, it's been cleansed, and Quinn has experienced that today. And this water doesn't cleanse him, it's just a symbol of what God's already done in his heart. So, Quinn, first question for you, is it your desire today to be baptized?
Yes.
Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your love. We're grateful for your hand of providence that leads and guides all the, what we might even consider the detours of our life, to lead us to a place where we come to know you and trust you, and to experience your grace and your forgiveness. So we're grateful today that you've done that in Quinn's life. We thank you for HL and Nikki, who have faithfully parented him and loved him and encouraged him and taught him your ways and pointed him in your direction. But we're grateful that today it's his decision to follow you. It's his decision to trust you. And we celebrate that today in this baptism. We pray that you would receive the glory and the honor today as we celebrate what you've done in his life. Amen. All right, Quinn, more questions. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and the counterfeit life that this world has to offer? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and your Savior, trusting in his grace and his love? Will you be a wholehearted follower of Jesus, obeying his word and showing his love? All right, now, congregation, family of God, we have a question for you. This is never done in isolation. Following Jesus is never about just a personal journey. It's always a journey of a community. And so I ask you, as the fellowship and the community of faith of which Quinn is a part, will you seek to continue to encourage Quinn to pour your life, to love him, to serve him, and to make sure that his faith continues to grow? If so, answer, we will. All right, Quinn McConnell, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful today for Quinn and his life, so thankful for the journey of faith that he's been on, so grateful for the gift of grace and forgiveness that you've given to him and that we all are reminded of in this moment where water is put on him. We're all reminded of your forgiveness. I pray, Lord, that this moment would be marked in Quinn's memory, that he would look back not only to his initial trusting of you, but even to this day where in the middle of his faith community, he stood up and said, I will follow Jesus. And that this would encourage him on his faith journey, prepare him for the days that lie ahead. It will be a tough journey. It'll be a joyful journey. It'll be an adventure, but it'll have some challenges. And so I pray, Lord, you would strengthen him and encourage him and equip him to follow you and be a witness to his generation. Pray you do this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Quaked before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. Well, it is.
Wow, what powerful words. You guys can be seated. It's powerful to sing that it is well with my soul, because I know sometimes you come in this room and you're anything but well. You feel anything but well. And we come into this place to bow down before our God to say, Lord, we're not well, but you're bigger. You're bigger than our problems. Lord, you're bigger than our anxieties. You're bigger than our lack of peace. And our prayer, that song is a prayer to say, Lord, let it be so that it would be well with my soul because of your strength and your spirit. You know, we're given that peace, not because of anything we've done, but because of God's great love for us. Because God is a giving God, because he gives us every good and perfect gift, we come and we worship him. And that's why part of our worship is giving back in this time that we call the offering. And so in a moment, we're going to pray that God would fill our hearts with his generosity, and that through these gifts that other people might hear that wonderful message, that through Jesus Christ, it is well. And after we pray, we're going to dismiss the kids to Kids Etc. So that they can learn the great truth about Jesus Christ. So let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that gives us a strength and a peace. Lord, even when all the circumstances around us tell us that we should feel otherwise, when all the circumstances of life seek to beat us down, Lord, we can say with confidence that it is well because of you. And that through everything we face, we can hold on to you and trust that you will get us through it. Lord, we thank you for that great and powerful gift. And Lord, we pray that as we take up this offering this morning and we reflect a little bit of your generosity back to you, that you would use these gifts to further your work out in our community, in this city, and throughout the world, that other people would know you as their Lord and their Savior. Lord, as we open up your word, let it do something in us. This is our prayer through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Kids K through third grade are dismissed to Kids Etc. right back there with Mr. Richie. And as the offering is coming around, we ask that you go ahead and get out your Bibles. And we're going to be looking at John chapter 13 today, in a very poignant moment with Jesus doing something that really shocked his disciples. So go ahead and get your Bibles out, John chapter 13, and then Kenny's going to come up and lead us through this wonderful discussion. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to his Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the very end. So during the supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going back to God, knowing all that, he rose from the supper and he laid aside his outer garments, and taking a towel, he tied it around his waist, and he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. And he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, do you wash my feet? And Jesus answered him, what I'm doing you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand. So Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. But Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no share with me. And so Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, the one who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not every one of you. For he knew who was going to betray him. That's why he said, not all of you are clean. When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and your teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done for you. This is God's holy and precious word.
I almost got baptized there. Well, what a it's always good to be together and to be worshiping together. It's always, to me, especially unique when we get to baptize someone. And it does mean that we're a little bit later than normal. I'm not going to guarantee you're going to be out by 11:30. So if that hurts your feelings or you need to leave, that's fine. This deserves our attention and focus this morning, so I really want us to kind of dive into this. Let's pray, though, as we begin. Heavenly Father, thank you that you've given us your word, and you've given us the great privilege of gathering together and praying and singing and worshiping you. And now, Lord, we've come to this moment where we want to hear you speak. As imperfectly as that may come through me, I just ask that you would, in fact, speak to each one in this room today. I'm only going to give one sermon, but I believe there'll be hundreds of sermons that are heard this morning as you, by your Spirit, apply the truth of this passage to each person here. So I pray that we would be open, and we would listen, and we would respond. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we are actually in a series of messages called Qualified. If you've been here the last few weeks, we've been looking basically at the unique ways in which Jesus is qualified or worthy as our Savior, how profoundly appropriate it is as we watch his life unfold, as we watch what he says, and the way in which what he says, what he teaches, and what he lives are so consistent. And so compelling, if you're looking at who Jesus is, how compelling it is that his life is so consistent. So we've looked at the way, week one, we looked at this parable that he told about a shepherd who leaves his flock to go after this one sheep that's been lost, and how that shows us the love of God. We then looked at the second week at how Jesus actually lives out that parable as he takes his disciples into kind of a pagan no man's land, to reach and to rescue this man called the demoniac. And then last week, Zach talked probably about the most difficult call to love, love for our enemies. We also looked at how Jesus perfectly loved his enemies, even as he's being crucified, even as he's suffering for us, he is still kind of stubbornly loving the people around him. Today we're going to kind of begin the second half of this series, and kind of the focus for the next 3 weeks as we lead all the way up to kind of Holy Week and Easter is going to be looking at the humility of Jesus, and the way in which his life was characterized by this path of constantly choosing to take the low place. And that path would ultimately lead him all the way to the cross. So today we're looking at John chapter 13. It's the only count we have in the four kind of accounts of Jesus' life, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John's the only one who kind of gives us this unique account of Jesus washing the disciples' feet. And a little bit of just kind of the setting. It is the Passover feast, so that's a Jewish festival. So Jesus has found himself in Jerusalem during this Jewish holiday, and he's celebrating this Passover meal, which was kind of a throwback to Israel's history, the Jewish history, a time when God had intervened and rescued them during the Exodus out of Egypt, but it's been celebrated since then, and so Jesus is now celebrating this meal with his disciples. We know this as the Last Supper. The custom in that day would have been, everybody would have been mainly wearing kind of open-toed shoes, right? And so it was not uncommon for those who could afford it, who had a household servant or a slave, to have offer at least to their guests that their feet could be washed. And so what Jesus does is during this meal, this task that would have been relegated to a servant's role, to a slave, probably the most kind of humbling, the most menial, the most lowly thing that could be offered to a guest, Jesus stuns his disciples when at the beginning of this meal, he gets up and he grabs the same basin that would have been reserved for the servant or the slave. And he grabs a towel and the outer garment that he was wearing, and he begins to wash his disciples' feet. And you can just imagine almost that they don't have a category for this. And they're almost kind of like, I would imagine this is playing out in slow motion. As they watch Jesus get up, I wonder what he's doing. Why is he grabbing the basin? Why? And all of a sudden, they're realizing these two things are merging, that what's usually reserved for a slave or a servant, Jesus is embodying, and he's taking it upon himself, and he begins to wash his disciples' feet. And of course, they're stunned by this, and you can see it in the way that Peter reacts, and he's just like, Lord, no, there's just no way I could ever let you wash my feet. Because in Peter's mind, he's just thinking, you're the Son of God. You're the master, you're the Lord, you're the teacher, you're the perfect one. You've never sinned, you've never done anything wrong. You deserve to be honored, you deserve to be held in high esteem. You certainly don't deserve to take the role of a servant or a slave and wash my feet. So Peter objects. But after there's some interaction about that, then Jesus closes this time with this huddle that he has with his disciples. He kind of brings them all in. And he wants to give them the why. He wants to tell them why this was so significant. And what he basically was saying is that what he said was, what I just did was to be a way of life for you. In other words, a willingness to love others through humility and servanthood. In other words, he's giving them kind of a living parable, a living symbol, a living demonstration of the kind of life that he lives and the kind of life that he wants his followers to live. This choice out of love for other people to do whatever it takes, to go as low as you have to go, to love and to serve and to meet the needs of the people around you. And you can just imagine, as I talked about Quinn and how today would be this memorable moment where hopefully he'll look back and he'll remember what it was like to stand here, and he'll remember the feeling of the water and the words that were spoken. You can only imagine what the disciples were feeling. After that moment, it was probably just this confused silence in the room as they realized what Jesus had just done. He had just washed their feet. My first question, though, when reading this was, how was this an act of profound love? Because that's the way the whole thing starts off. In verse 1, it says that Jesus, having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. Or he now took his love all the way. Some of your translations might read differently. But in other words, John's telling us that what I'm about to tell you that Jesus did, this was an act of love. All right, this wasn't just a moral story. This wasn't just this was an act of love. So my first question was, in what sense was this an act of love? I mean, I think humility, yeah. I mean, it could be an act of humility. But in what sense did this really help the disciples? Right? I mean, their feet were going to be dirty again. And they could have cleaned their own feet. So how does this benefit them? And the answer is, this is an unforgettable demonstration or an illustration of love controlling somebody's life instead of self. Think about that for a minute. This was a tangible, vivid demonstration or example to the disciples. This is what it looks like when somebody's life is controlled by love of others rather than love of self. And what a huge truth that would turn out to be. Jesus loved them by showing them that self-focus, which is really pride, is not the pathway to true life. Otherwise, we're stuck in this trap of pride and self-focus, and these are the kind of questions that haunt us. Here's where this is relevant for us. If that's what Jesus is offering his disciples, is a different path, a way to escape pride and self-focus, and it reminds us of the kind of questions that we ask ourselves oftentimes throughout any given day. What do others think of me? Right? How will this benefit me? How does this person threaten me? What will I lose? What do I have to gain? How do I get mine? What if I get cheated out of that promotion or that bonus at work? What if I get passed over or taken advantage of or forgotten? What if the coach doesn't play me enough? What if people don't realize what I bring to the table? What if people find out how I have failed and what I've done? What if they don't make room for my suggestions and my ideas and my voice? What if someone else has better grades or a higher GPA? How do I get respect and honor? How do I make sure people notice me and think highly of me? Right? I mean, those are the questions that trap us in self-focus. When that's all we've got, that's all we've got going, you notice that recurring theme of I and me and mine. And that's the suffocating trap of pride and self-focus. And Jesus was teaching his followers about this different way of life. Right? It reminds me, that kind of self-focus reminds me, I don't know what movie it was in, but it was a Bette Midler quote where she says one time, she goes, all right, enough about me, let's talk about you. What do you think about me? Right? And that's just our reflex. That's our instinct, how quickly we go back to how do I turn this situation back to me? And that's what Jesus is trying to show his disciples, a way out of that trap. And what Jesus shows us in this thing is he kind of shows that there's this kind of triple threat, that these three things kind of converge in Jesus' life that empower him to be so different. I mean, you can imagine how often people just scratched their heads and looked at Jesus, just kind of without a category really for who he was and how he related to people, how often they were shocked and surprised. And I think it boils down, and this passage completely demonstrates this, that there were three things that converge in Jesus that show us this way out of the trap of self-focus. The first one is that he was loved by God, and he knew it. I mean, you notice the multiple references to his father just in verses 1 through 3. It says he knew that it was his time had come to leave this world and go to his father. In verse 3, it says he knew that the Father had put all things under his power and they had come from God and was returning to God. In other words, Jesus understood that he was loved by his Father. And his whole life was oriented and centered and orbited around this reality that he was loved by his Father, that he was right in the center of what his dad had sent him to do, that his dad knew what was about to happen. He knew it from all eternity. And Jesus felt comfort and safety and security in the middle of that. He knew he was loved. Right after his baptism, at the beginning of his earthly ministry, in Matthew 3, it says that a voice came from heaven that said, "This is my Son, whom I love, and with whom I'm well pleased." Why was it important for Jesus to hear that as he began his public ministry? Right? Why doesn't it come afterwards? Why doesn't it come as the reward of being obedient, or the reward of loving and serving and sacrificing and dying on the cross? You see, Jesus knew he had it before he was obedient. He knew at the beginning of his earthly ministry that he heard his Father say, "Listen, this is my Son Jesus, and I love him, and I'm well pleased with him." Right? And that gave Jesus a sense of anchor to his identity. It secured him. His purpose and his mission were in the hands of his Father, and he knew it. So that was the first thing. The second thing was he was free from self-focus. Though he was painfully aware of his impending suffering and death, his attention and concern was on his disciples. I mean, think about that. He says he knew full well that the time had come to finish his mission, which he knew had to mean that he would be betrayed, that he'd be abandoned by his disciples, that he would ultimately be falsely accused, that he would spend all night in these kind of clown bogus trials, right? That he'd be spit on and humiliated and ridiculed, and ultimately beaten to within an inch of his life before he was staked to a cross and would die on the cross. Now, with all that on his mind, what does it tell us that he wants to do? He wants to show the full extent of his love to his disciples. Now, you think about that for a minute, okay? Think back to a time in your life when you were either in the middle of some kind of suffering or trial. Maybe it was a physical pain. Maybe it was some kind of relational conflict that was going on. Or maybe you knew that something was coming, right? Maybe it was some kind of a surgery or some kind of a painful procedure that you were going to go through. Something that you had to pass through. There was no way of avoiding it, and it just kind of loomed over you because you knew it was coming. Let me ask you, in those moments, is it your instinct to be thoughtful and considerate of others? No. We get consumed. It's almost like we collapse in on ourselves. At least that's true for me. When I get sick or I'm going through some kind of trial or some kind of suffering, some kind of, you know, difficult time in my life, I mean, I just collapse in on myself. And here Jesus does the complete opposite, right? And that's because he was free from that kind of self-focus. He was compelled by love to serve others, which is really the third thing. So he knew he was loved by God. He was free from that kind of self-focus, which led to this ability to love and to serve his disciples. And there's two things to me that show up for this. Two things why this is such a compelling account and why this is really relevant for us. The first is that Jesus shows us the true definition of humility. And secondly, he shows us the path of humility. He shows us the true definition of humility. And what I want to do for just a second is I normally don't like when people read to me out of something, but I didn't feel like I could do this justice without reading this from you. This is from a book called The Freedom of Self-Forgetfulness. It's by Tim Keller. And I want you just to read, listen to this for just a minute. When you think of how you would have defined pride or humility, I want you to see how this is really kind of an insightful look at this and an insightful look into the heart of Jesus. Tim Keller says, C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity makes a brilliant observation about gospel humility at the very end of his chapter on pride. If we were to meet a truly humble person, he says, we would never come away from that meeting thinking that they were humble. They would not always be telling us that they were a nobody, because a person who keeps saying they're a nobody is actually a self-obsessed person. The thing we would remember from meeting a truly gospel humble person is how much they seem to be totally interested in us. Because the essence of gospel humility, and listen to this, I wish I had said this. Because the essence of gospel humility is not thinking more of myself or thinking less of myself. It is thinking of myself less. Gospel humility is not needing to think about myself, not needing to connect everything to myself. It is an end to thoughts such as, I'm in this room with these people, and does that make me look good, or do I want to be here? True gospel humility means I stop connecting every experience, every conversation with myself. In fact, I stop thinking about myself. The freedom of self-forgetfulness, the blessed rest that only self-forgetfulness brings. True gospel humility means an ego that is not puffed up, but filled up. This is totally unique. Are we talking about high self-esteem? No. So is it low self-esteem? Certainly not. It is not about self-esteem at all. Paul simply refuses to play that game. He says, I don't care about your opinion, but I don't care that much about my opinion either, and that is the secret. A truly gospel humble person is not a self-hating person or a self-loving person, but a gospel humble person. The truly gospel humble person is a self-forgetful person whose ego is just like his or her toes. It just works. It does not draw attention to itself. The toes just work. The ego just works. Neither draws attention to itself. But I love that what he ultimately says is that it's not that we think less. So the path, if I were to say, okay, I get it. Jesus was humble. He washed disciples' feet. He tells us we ought to be humble. How do you get there? Most of us would say, well, the way you battle pride and you get to humility is you stop thinking really good things about yourself and you realize what a worthless worm you are. Right? In some form or fashion, you might not have said it that dramatically, but that's kind of the way we think. That's how we get to humility, is we realize how worthless we are. And what he's saying is what Paul knew and what Jesus knew is that's not the path at all. The path is to be so consumed by the love of God that we're so secure in who we are and that we're loved by him and that we're forgiven by him, that we're then freed up to not have to think good or bad, high or low about ourselves. But instead, we're freed up to just fill our minds with other people. What are their needs? What would it look like to serve them? What are they going through? What's it like to walk a mile in their shoes? How can I use what God's given me to bless and to serve other people? Jesus knew who he was. He knew whose he was. He knew he was loved and approved of by his heavenly Father. So rather than being consumed with concern about his identity and self-worth, he was free to meet the needs of his disciples. And in this case, it meant he knew he had to go all the way down to the lowest point. He had to become a servant. He had to do what only a slave would do. And it didn't bother him. It didn't shake his identity. He didn't feel like anything was at risk by giving up his own sense of nobility or pride. He was willing to go low. And for those who have trusted him and are following him, he offers that same kind of freedom. So I just want to think about this in kind of two like real life situations, all right? Let's just first think about this, for example. If God were to give us more and more this ability in our marriages or dating relationships, whatever kind of situation that might be, but just think about this. If God's love is central and you're learning how to let a love for your spouse or your significant other control you rather than a love for self, then you can imagine you'd be more thoughtful, considerate, patient, you'd be willing to confess faults and ask forgiveness, right? But if the love of self is at the center of those relationships, then pride kicks in and you're demanding and selfish, oblivious to the needs and fixated on your own, unwilling to serve when things don't go your way, right? You begin to negotiate mutual selfishness in your relationships. In other words, when you realize that the other person really has to have your best interests at heart and you don't really have their best interests at heart, you just negotiate. If you stay together, you figure out how do we negotiate for mutual selfishness. And when there's hurt and conflict, you have to win and be right. You won't own your sin and your faults. And when you're hurt, you seek revenge when you wake up. And then all of a sudden what happens is you realize that slowly over time, what you really wanted in your marriage or your relationship, which was oneness and respect and trust and safety and friendship and fun and adventure, that's what you envisioned. And all that's been stolen by pride. I was talking with my son Connor yesterday. We were just kind of talking about relationships and marriage. And I was just telling him, I was like, you know, but I really can't recount all the times that Jenny and I, it was his mom and I, you know, that we would not have made it if it weren't for God's grace. I was just telling him, I said, listen, when people say, oh, 50% of marriages end in divorce, I'm like, oh, gasp, shock. I'm shocked that 50% of them stay together. Marriage is hard, right? And the Bible doesn't romanticize or idealize marriage, right? It treats it as a gift, as an amazing thing that God's given us, but it's not idealized or romanticized. It's hard, especially in a broken world where we're all fallen and selfish. And I was just telling him, bud, we would not have made it if it weren't for the wisdom of God that people deposited in us and the Word of God, which is we try to let guide our marriage and the intervention oftentimes of other people who've stepped in and kind of said, hey, wake up, what's going on? We would not have made it. We wouldn't be where we are. An example of that was just 2 months ago, we were kind of having a parenting crisis with one of our kids, and the stakes were high and the emotions were running high, and it was kind of late one night when all this kind of came to a head, and we got kind of finished handling that a little bit, and so our son left the room, and it wasn't Connor, but our son left the room. It was one of them, though, that started with a C. So left the room, and so then we started dialoguing about what's next and how to handle it and what are the consequences going to be, and then we got into a big conflict. And because we were so exhausted and tired from the drama with their child and all this other stuff, we're at the end of ourselves. We lost it, and we began lashing out and saying things to each other that just were just not kind, and we just lost it. Right? In fact, we went to bed in separate rooms, which we hardly ever have done in our marriage. We know that's not wise. We know that's what the Bible counsels to do, but we did. Next morning, I wake up, and things are kind of crazy in the mornings, and I take Cooper to school, and I'm on my way back, and I'm just almost just sick over the conflict and this the way we're, Jenny and I, the condition of our relationship. But I started rehearsing everything that had happened. I was like, yeah, but she said this, and that wasn't right, and she handled this way, and that wasn't right. And I think I was right about this, right? I mean, just you get into your own head, and you get convinced of how right you are. And I was like, well, I should probably go home, or I should call, or I should somehow try to initiate, you know, that we're going to try to work this out or whatever. And I was like, yeah, but she should have to do that because she was more wrong than I was. And so, you know, you start going off through all this stuff. And then I just felt like I heard the whisper of the Holy Spirit, this passage that has saved us time and time again, where he says, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And I thought, you know, who cares who's right or wrong? I want my marriage more than I want to be right. And so I went home, and Jenny was in the kitchen, and I just said, babe, here's all the ways I blew it last night, and I'm sorry. Here's what I was scared of. Here's what I was fearful about. Here's what I was prideful about. And I mean, I didn't even get done talking and confessing before Jenny was crying and confessing and apologizing. And I was just like, you know, only God does that. Only God comes through on that promise that if we go low, if we'll trust him, if we don't have to be right all the time, if we don't have to be the one who wins the argument, if we'll just trust him to say he opposes us when we're proud, but if we're humble, his grace can come into those situations, that he does, and he rescues those situations. And that was one of those moments. Jenny and I have taken turns countless times over 21 years of marriage seeking his grace through humility. Otherwise, there's no way we would have made it. So marriage and those dating relationships are just a huge place where you could see this principle work out. The second and last one would just be this: money and possessions. Think about this for a second. If God's love has settled your self-worth, then your money and possessions are controlled by love and compassion, not selfishness. The need to measure up or to compare with others, the fear and the insecurity about the future, or to try and fill emotional and spiritual emptiness through spending, that gets thrown out. It gets displaced by the love of God as that settles into our hearts, so that instead we're able to steward over our resources with wisdom and generosity and freedom. And when you're generous or compassionate, you don't need to be recognized for it. And I was thinking about that. I was like, you know, how much of my spending is controlled by the needs of others? Think about all the financial decisions you make on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. How many of those is one of the first questions you ask, will this benefit the needs of somebody other than me and my family? And that just shows us sometimes how much we are controlled still by this need that money and possessions would somehow say something about our self-worth or our satisfaction or our identity. And you could just do this in every category of life, in friendships and dating and sports and work and career, your involvement here at the church or in other ministries. The quality and the direction of every relationship and endeavor that you're a part of is being impacted by how you define your self-worth. To the degree that your identity is unsettled, then you will be controlled by self-focus, which inevitably leads to pride, fear, and insecurity. That's just the truth. Only God's love can anchor our identity and free us to be controlled by a love for others rather than a love of self. So how do we get there? How do we cultivate that kind of settled identity? How does that just become not something we talk about and we don't look at that like, oh, that's kind of ideal what he was talking about, but we live in the real world where that can't happen, right? I mean, the New Testament believers, Jesus believed this could be a reality for us. So much so that he died to offer us this kind of freedom and this kind of self-assured identity that's anchored in him. So how do we get there? I was at a Cooper Plays Baseball at Peterson Park, and we had a game this past week a couple nights ago, and we did pretty well through about four innings, and then we got killed. So that in the last inning, we were down 23-7, right? Which sounds like a football score, but it was actually baseball. But that's how far we were just getting demolished by this team, right? But the kids were actually had a kind of a cool attitude. They were just kind of put the rally caps on and like, oh man, we're going to come back and score all these runs. And nobody really believed that, right? But they just decided to have fun with it, which was kind of cool that they did that. Well, we get like four or five runs, and then there's two outs, and this last kid comes up to bat, and he gets up there, and, you know, everybody kind of knows this is the end of the game. Most parents would like it to end at this point because it's past 9 o'clock. He strikes out, which I thought, who cares? The game's over. We knew we were going to lose, whatever. So he comes running around, and we were going through the line to shake hands with the other players, and his dad is one of the other coaches, and I just looked back and saw that he was crying. And I overheard him say to his dad was like, hey, what is the problem? And he said, I lost the game for our team. Now think about that. I mean, we're down 23. He couldn't have won it or lost it. It had nothing to do with him. We were going to be beat, period. Had nothing to do with him. But you can imagine the way he owned that kind of pressure, that kind of performance. He could hear his teammates cheering him, you know, get a hit, whatever, keep this thing. And he felt all that kind of pressure. And I wonder how many of us live under that kind of pressure every day. That every day, every interaction we have or task that we undertake or challenge we face, we feel we are proving our self-worth. When things go well, we swell with pride. When things go poorly, we're crushed with shame and insecurity. But either way, proving our self-worth is a controlling and suffocating and unrelenting way of life. That's what Jesus came to rescue us from. HL, you guys can go on, come on back up and get ready to kind of close us with a final song. I want you to hear these words, because to me, that's not the life that Jesus died for us to have. The kind of life that lives with that kind of fear of disapproval or that kind of fear of failure or the sense that I don't measure up and I can't be good enough and I can't do, that's exhausting and that's crippling. And that's not what Jesus wanted for us. So after Jesus washes his disciples' feet and shares this final meal, he's betrayed by Judas. He's abandoned by his disciples. He's falsely accused and beaten and humiliated and finally crucified on a cross, on a trash heap outside of Jerusalem. All of which was his choice. He said earlier in the book of John, chapter 10, he says, nobody takes my life from me. I lay my life down because that's what a good shepherd does. He knew that it was the only way that our guilt and our shame and our sin could be forgiven and done away with. And he now offers us grace and forgiveness and welcome into the family of God as sons and daughters. That's what was purchased for us. That's what was offered as a gift to us. So the struggle for self-worth is over. Just as he said to Jesus, he says to those who trust in him, this is my son or my daughter, whom I love and with whom I'm well pleased. So the question today for you is, if you're a follower of Christ, if you've trusted in Jesus, do you feel like that's kind of the soundtrack of your life? That at any given moment, you can just kind of go back to that moment and just remember, man, in my best days and on my worst days, I can hear that echo of my Heavenly Father saying, you know what? I love you, and with you I'm well pleased. Because that's what Jesus died for. That's what the gospel offers us. And that's a declaration, that's a settled fact for eternity, all because Jesus was willing to pay for our sin on the cross. Romans 8:1 says, therefore, there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So we should marvel at the humility and the sacrificial love of our Savior. Even if we hadn't talked about that humility and that freedom that's offered us, just simply watching Jesus and looking at who he is should cause us to just be kind of marvel at him and just say, what a Savior we have. But it's amazing that it goes beyond that, because he calls us to honor him by following that humility and love for others. Has that been a struggle for you? As you kind of inventory your life this morning, where are the places and the relationships where you're still trying to secure your self-worth rather than living off of the love of God? The invitation this morning has come to him to say, Heavenly Father, I'm sorry. Rather than just accepting it and letting that your love settle into my life, I'm still kind of living off of a sense that I got to earn it and I got to gain it and I got to secure it for myself. Would you please forgive me? And would you please kind of flood my heart again with your love so that I can be freed up to not be so self-focused and give my life away for the sake of others? That's the call. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love. Thank you that it changes us. It anchors us. It secures us. And it touches our marriages, our friendships, our money, our careers, our hobbies, our sports. It should touch every aspect of life. Would you help us to have that truth settle into our hearts this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that your love is overwhelming and lavish and extravagant, and it has made us your sons and daughters, and we are forgiven and beloved. I pray, Lord, that you would anchor us in that identity and send us out from this place to make that love tangible and real in our world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a good week.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you.